Uh-oh. Cheating, cheating, cheating.
You guys already saw what I want to show. Yeah, hi guys, I'm Kumar Rangarajan from his company Slang Labs. We are a startup here in Bangalore. We work on building voice augmented experiences for mobile applications. We provide a platform that allows you to add an Alexa-like experience inside your mobile app. That's a helpful thing. Let's not worry about that part right now. So what we are here to talk about, what I am here to talk about, here is this notion of what is this notion of voice augmented experiences, right? And why you should do it, and does it make sense? Hopefully, at the end of it, you can at least get convinced that this is a worthy enough notion to get tried out. So we'll talk about the pro cons and what way to do it. Sorry, my voice is pathetic. I don't know if you guys can even hear what I'm talking. I'm just mumbling. I have a bad throat. Sorry. So let's start with first talking about like voice, right? Like voice is now, why voice? Why voice is now becoming important, and what are the advantages that work? There's a lot of hype around voice. Right? Google is pushing it. Amazon is pushing it. There's a lot of hype. So forget the hype part of it. Let's talk about the what value does voice fundamentally give to a brand or to an application developer? These are some of them. The first thing is like as an end user, right? Some of them from the end user perspective, some of them from the company perspective. From the end user perspective, it allows you to get your job done the fastest. You think of something, you can get it done the fastest. Now today, if you want to be able to not get done in any mobile application, you think of something, then you convert them into a series of click, 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 and somewhere after some n number of clicks, you get your job done. Right? That's the current state of the art when we have to get things done today. So like thinking to getting it done is a long gap away. But with voice, think, get done. So that's like the big leap of jump. Today when we're all app developers here, right? How many of our parents can actually use their own apps? Anybody? Parents can use apps they actually have developed? Right? Did you raise your hand or? Oh, great. That's great. Like one among 50. Right? So this is a common scenario, right? And our parents are, and most, I'm assuming, are not necessarily not educated or not. Really, they're all educated. Most people are educated, are studying, are worked in good places, but still they can't use our tech. The tech their own kids build. Right? But with voice, like people when they use Alexa, if you've seen your parents use Alexa, it's much more easier. Right? It's a much more newer tech. They can start using voice much more immediately because it just opens up to a lot more people. Because of voice and the fact that sometimes languages become a barrier, so that it becomes a huge part. Another thing is it's very natural. Like this is actually a big trigger for us to even start Slang. When I watch my kids start using Alexa, 4-year-old daughter, first time she sees Alexa, she watches me how to use it. It just becomes instinctive action. Second time onwards, she just, no training needed. She just understands how to use it. Like this is not a unique experience. I'm sure all of us who experience watching kids use systems like Alexa and Google Home are amazed by it. No training. It's so natural to be able to know, speak it. Because you're all born with that ability to speak. And another interesting thing, this is from a developer also perspective, is like to be able to know, understand the true intent. Right? Like typically if you want as a user, as a developer, you want to understand what the user is actually intending to do. You know that he came to the screen and he did something, but you are not sure about his intention. He clicked this button, he clicked that button, that's all. You have discrete pieces of information and you ought to put together the discrete piece of information to collect, understand what exactly was he thinking in his mind. Right? But with voice, you now get to know the true intent. Whether you can handle it or not is a different story. But the fact that you can now collect the true intent of the user, much more straightforward, is a great value. This is now not necessarily from an end user, but from a user perspective. And cognitive overload. You're not blocked by the fact that, oh, I have to go through navigation, there are small screens, scroll, I don't know what how to do. It's much more easier, much more intuitive. So these are all some of the advantages that voice fundamentally give you. But today, when we talk about voice, we are talking about an assistant-backed voice experience. Right? Whether it is Alexa, Google Home, or Siri, anything, it's an assistant-centric voice experience. That's what we fundamentally talk about. But that they are separate channels. Typically, you have to end up separating, building it for them. This is a separate parallel channel. But most of us already have a native app. Not necessarily native app, or whether it's a Flutter app or a React Native app. We already have apps. And that's a fundamentally, that's our biggest channel that which customers today use. And there are a lot of advantages. I'm
sorry, can anybody even read this bad contrast? It's okay. Read this.
There's going to be a lot of this contrast in the rest of the slides. Great. So there are a lot of advantage. There are a lot of value that apps fundamentally give. Let's look at some of the fundamental apps value that apps still have today in today's world. One is this notion of discoverability. Like, there's a Play Store. I know how to discover them. There's a well-established process. The voice systems will also eventually hopefully get there. Today, if you want to discover an Alexa skill, it's not so obvious. People will figure it out, but it's here it's much discovered. And what you can do and what you can't do when you're in front of Alexa is not obvious because it's completely voice only. So it is non-intuitive sometimes to understand what it can do. But in an app, there are buttons kind of gives you a sense of a context for what I can do and what I cannot do. But some of them are, the counter example is like some of the capabilities are so hard to discover in the app because they are so nested type. But in voice, everything is fine. But typically, there's an advantage. The market is very mature. You're not dependent on a parallel ecosystem to grow. You don't need more and more Alexa devices and Google Home devices to be grown. You already have smartphones. Smartphone is a well-established market. You already have apps. They have billions of hundreds, millions of users using it already. So you can, that's an existing advantage. Engineeringly mature. Right? And we're all engineers, mostly people here. And then simple things like login. If you want to do a login in Alexa, it's a pain. You have to now rediscover it. If you want to be able to now, a lot of things that is well solved in an Android and a mobile ecosystem has to be rediscovered. We're now trying to solve it in a parallel ecosystem like a voice-only system. And a lot of functionalities are very UI-only. Like if you're trying to order a pizza, this is my classic example, you're trying to order a pizza via a voice-only system. Say, I want a pizza. Question is like, which pizza do you want? I don't know what pizza I want. Like, you have to give me a choice. Oh, veggie pizza, cheese pizza, macaroni. I've already forgotten the first pizza that I want because it's humanly we'll forget. Humans can't take more than 3 to 5 things in their mind at any point of time. That's where a lot of things are still very helpful for visuals. Like when you have a list, it's a lot more easy to process that list. And last but not the least is the notion of privacy. Of privacy, because when you're working with an app, it's you and your brand, the customer and the brand directly. There is no middleman. There is no middleman. But when you have a third-party app integration, there is a middleman that you go through. You have to get logged in by the person. The question is asked by the middleman. Answer is passed through the middleman. So everything is tracked by a middleman. And the middleman not only knows about you, it also knows about the other parallel brands. So this, and both from a brand's perspective and also from the end user's perspective, my knowledge is not just allowed with this one person, but I'm now sharing it with a lot more people. Or with this one guy who essentially understands a lot more about me now. Now that's a potential concern. It might be a concern for some, might not be, but this is a big concern for a lot of people. These are all, now this problem doesn't exist in an app because the relationship is very personal, you and the brand. So now these are all advantages that a mobile application gives you. How can we get the best of both? We saw the lot of advantages that voice gives you. Now there are a lot of advantages that a mobile application gives you. Now can we combine these two and get the best of both?
Now that's what we call as the VAX experience, where you augment an existing visual experience by voice and get the best of both worlds. So that's the whole idea behind this word called VAX. Now a lot of words, right? This theoretical words. We all like to see in code or in action. Well, let's see a demo, a quick demo of what does it look like. Flip screens. Just can you hear it? Yeah. Yeah,
so this is a live usage, like this is from one of the apps at the lab. It took so long to be able to get to what you want to be able to do.
Activate the 1-day international roaming pack to USA.
Okay, 1-day international roaming pack for USA will be activated. Please confirm.
Activate international roaming.
Which country are you traveling to?
United States.
Which pack would you like to buy? Okay, one day international roaming pack for USA will be activated. Please confirm.
मुझे इंटरनेशनल रोमिंग चालू करना है।
आप किस देश की यात्रा कर रहे हैं?
USA.
आप कौन सा पैक चाहते हैं?
एक दिन का पैक।
यूनाइटेड स्टेट्स ऑफ अमेरिका के लिए की अंतर्राष्ट्रीय रोमिंग पैक सक्रिय है।
This is example of an experience that you can build with what we call as voice augmented experience. You have an existing application which you can continue to navigate, but now you can add voice to be able to now skip a lot of problems. One is to be able to know the navigational complexity and also the language complexity. Now it allows you, even my mom can now start using this kind of an app where she doesn't have to worry about how to do it. Just say what to and the app will now react. If she misses something, the app should be able to know, prompt back and be able to collect all the missing pieces of the journey. Right? So that's the thing about this notion of accent. Now, what all can you do with this notion? What does it now fundamentally enable with VAX use cases? Like here, one we saw, it allows you to now, it flattens the entire hierarchy. Different parts of your application can now be reached almost like in a single shot. So single voice command or a single voice interaction, which now allows you to now go deep into any application. And depending on what you say, you can either drop them at step 3 or step 2 or step 1, depending on how complex the user utterance is. Or if there are cases where there's a lot of data to be collected, assuming you have a form, you'll be able to now collect it. Now ensure that the user filling one by one, field by field. User can now more natively speak out what he's trying to say, which conveys the entire form. One classic example is the notion of an address. When you want to be able to now take an address,
you don't want to say like street name. This is not how we typically, when we ask someone, we don't break it down part by part and say, we just speak the address in one shot. And it's up to the system to now be able to extract the relevant information. Or I think of another case like where like somebody who is now taking a repairman who is now trying to test a car. He says, okay, left. Typically, he has a form where he has to say, okay, left tire is done, right tire is done, left front tire is done, right front tire. So each section has to be explicitly marked. But in voice, you can just say, like, all tires are done. So now you can now, and it is up to the app to now to be able to now convert all tires into those all four fields that it matters. Because that's a much more natural way to now be able to now speak. It cut shorts a lot of steps. And a lot of times, there are a lot of data that is actually exist in your application, but people can't discover them. They end up calling customer care. So banks, one of the for example, the top call that they get is to get their balance. And the balance is a pretty easy information that most of us can retrieve from our banking app. But for a lot of people, it is not obvious.
We actually did I don't have a video of it, right, but I can show it to a different. Like we actually did a small user research where we took a lady who earns around 35,000 rupees a month as a maid, and she collects other things. But because of the fact she didn't understand how to operate the app, natively navigate, balance operation which is right there on the front of the app, she didn't know how she had to click it. She just kept clicking all over the place for like 10-5 minutes to be able to now just get that basic balance operation. And the net result is they end up calling customer care and waste a lot of money for that brand. But you could just, if they could have opened it and used it in the app, that would be a lot more easier. And last but not the least is the notion of breaking barriers. Now, typically, when you want to be able to now target more languages, the normal model is to be able to localize your application. Now, localizing application is typically a costly operation because you have to localize every single screen and make it happen. And typically, even for most of us, if you look at ourselves, we don't really want, many times, I don't want to really read in my native language. I want to speak in my native language, but I'm not so comfortable reading in my native language. But I'm okay to now parse info, and most of the output is typically visual or in images. I can understand the meaning. But I can't tell a command to it. I can't express what I want to the application typically. So that's where a bigger challenge starts coming in. So with voice allowing you to now convert and handle the language part of it, even if your application is fundamentally still English, you can still handle other languages. So without you having to now fundamentally change your application to multilingual, you can now allow a multilingual user or a non-English user to start using your application. So that's another thing that starts coming in. And typically when you build VAX, there are two ways in which you can build out a VAX experience. One way is called as a one-shot action, or a voice-guided navigation, augmented navigation. A one-shot action is where the user speaks something, a sentence, and based on how complex or how deep thing he faces, you go deeper into the application and then continue the rest of the journey by touch. You don't want to always keep using everything voice. The user spoke something, you take them deep in and then you continue by touch. Or he speaks something, then there is something missing. Then you keep asking him more information. Keep asking more information until all information that you need has been collected. Until you enter the reach the end of it.
And a kind of IVR style model of like navigating the user based on what he's speaking. So both things are possible. These are all multiple ways in which you can actually add voice kind of an experience into your application.
Now, if you want to be able to make it happen, so what are the fundamental things that you have to be cognizant of? So what does it mean? Because like typically when you're building as an Android developer and iOS developer, we are focused on UI elements and there are different style that we think of. But the moment you think of the notion of voice, there's a different kind of a paradigm that you also have to start understanding. There are certain terminologies and texts that starts coming in. The first thing, let's start the basics. Are these four fundamental concepts called intents, entities, prompts, utterances? Like if anybody has worked on dialogue flow and other NLP systems, some of these terms might be familiar. But typically when we use the system, they are like for a particular reason for chatbot building, that's where you start using. So now our proposal is to be able to now say, can you now use it primarily in your main application as part of your navigation experience, as part of your form filling, as part of your
direct user experience, can you now start using voice? Now, which means that even mainstream app developers also have to start understanding some kind of these kind of terminologies has to be understood. So it's good if people understand.
So intents, entities, prompts, I'll explain what each of these things mean short. So intents are the actions that the user wants to perform. Like this essentially breaks down to a top level action, like that user wants to be able to perform. Examples, he wants to book a ticket. And then there is he wants a list of flights. He wants to see the list of flights that is available. He wants to filter a particular option or he wants to cancel it. These are all examples. And there is typically a noun that describes the action, a verb that describes an action that he wants to be able to perform. So this is how you describe, start with an intent definition. And they are all typically mapped to something that is executable in your application. At the end of an intent, something should be able to do in your application. If you can't act anything on it, then it's not an intent. It's just a part of the whole journey. An act. The next thing is an entities. Now to complete that intent, what are the data I want? Like if I want my banking application, if I want to be able to now see my balance, typically I don't need any data. Because just the fact that the user has expressed that I want to be able to see my balance, I can now go ahead and try to show him the balance. But if he wants to be able to now book a flight, for example, in this particular case, to be able to complete that action, to be able to get to something logical next step, I need some basic information to be able to collect it with. Like for example, I need to be able to collect the source city. I need to be able to collect the destination city. I need to know the date. Without these three information, I can't even go to the next screen sort of. I can't even take them to the next screen. So these are all basic information that I need to be able to collect. Now some of them might be optional, some of them might be mandatory. Depending on how much data that you want, you'll be able to know. The next one is the notion of utterances. Now, utterances are the actual sentences or the commands that a user will speak, which will differentiate between various intents. Now, the user he has an intent. Now, he wants to be able to express that in a certain way. Now, what ways in which is he going to be explaining? And so, to be able to now understand what are the ways in somebody could trigger that. Now, in this particular example, now those are all different ways for someone to say, hey, initiate booking a ticket operation. So, that's what they're saying. They could say in different ways. Or these are like different ways in which here these are saying, hey, is there a ticket available? Can I book? So here it is more like a question, sort of like an FAQ question, or it could be something like where he's asking, is there a ticket available? I don't want to actually book a ticket. I just want to know if a ticket is available. So you want to be able to differentiate between these two. So then they typically become two different intents. So because depending on what the user speaks, you want your application to do different things. Now if your application can't handle two things, then you essentially map them all to the same action. But if you can slice them into different, and then that's where you start. Prompts are things that you speak back to be able to collect information from the user. Like now in this particular case, the user said Bangalore, Delhi, 21st. Now, but there are a lot of missing information that is still needed. I don't know how many tickets to book. I don't know if there is a one-way or a return journey. Or if it is a return journey, what is the date for the return journey? Now those information is missing. So now these are all concepts that you have to be able to understand. Now, these things typically we do that in our normal programming model as fields in a form. So that's how we think of them as. But in the world, when you start thinking of the world as a voice system, these are all the terminologies that people start using. This notion of prompts, this notion of entities, notion of utterances. The last one is the notion of confirmation. Now, when the user says something, you typically want to be able to speak back to the user, also in voice. Even ideally, you also want a visual to be backing it up, but also some kind of a audio prompt, also audio confirmation also comes in. He says, would you like to continue? Like he says, spoke something, you show something, and then you want to be able to speak something. It can be a positive statement where, okay, showing you flights from Bangalore to Chennai on 21st. That's a very positive statement. Or it can be a negative statement saying, hey, there are no flights available to you on that particular day. So, like, technically, it will be the same list. It could be the same list, and the list could be empty in one case, and the list could be filled in one another case. But you want to be able to now speak back because the user spoke, you also want an audio confirmation. So there was a thing that was done, trial, that was a test was done with Alexa and Google Home. Which is a more trusted brand? Which do you feel more trusted between Alexa and Google? So survey overwhelmingly said Alexa was more trustworthy. Even though Google was able to now respond to most queries much more efficiently than Alexa. They were always able to get a correct answer, but Alexa was a more trusted brand. Apart from the fact name is Alexa and the human element for it, another reason that was given was the fact that when you say, hey, book a reminder for 4 p.m. tomorrow, Alexa will confirm back saying, okay, booking a reminder for 4 p.m. Now that gave you a confidence that I spoke something, the system now did the right thing for me. The response was, okay, done. Oh, I don't know what you did. So now, because when you engineeringly now coded, it seems like a very efficient way to say, okay, done, right? But you don't want to say, okay, done. You want to say, what did you do? So that kind of, these tiny things make a huge difference in people's mindset and what you do and what you not do. So now all those things starts coming into play when you start using voice. Now you want to be able to now differentiate between different types of confirmations, like how do you now speak back? So those are the fundamentals, like the intents, entities are the fundamental building blocks that anybody has to be able to understand. The not so basics are this notion of context. When a person is speaking, you also want to be able to now maintain this notion called context. Now, for example, in that continuing the previous conversation, the user is now saying, hey, show me flights to Chennai or to Chennai. Now, one way is like saying, okay, now tell me the from city, which date you want to travel, because everything is a restart. You can think of it as a fresh command and fresh handling, everything. But a smarter system would say like, hey, a super confident system, will just say, okay, assume he wants to go from the same source city to a different destination city on the same date, and then directly show him the list, get to the next point. But a more midpoint was to be able to now make the assumption, but confirm. Confirm with the user saying, hey, okay, are you saying that you want to book a ticket from Bangalore to Chennai on 21st? Is that what you are now trying to intend? Because now you are trying to change the flow suddenly, but I have context of your previous conversation. Now using that context, I don't want to just directly jump, but I want to maintain, but tell you, is this what you intended? Or did you intend something else? Now, this is something to experiment with. Now, some people might not want this confirmation directly go, why are you even asking me this question? Some people might want this confirmation. But since it's a new era, it's always better to take the confirmation and use it. Another thing is multimodality. Now, the disadvantage of Alexa is like it's a purely voice-first system, or voice-only and a voice-first system. But when you now do VAX, when you are augmenting an existing visual experience by voice, you should take advantage of the fact that there are visuals backing you. And people are not forced to only use voice or visuals. You want to have a very seamless marriage between these two. For example, in this particular case, you say, which flight would you like to book? Right? And now you're showing, the user said, book a flight from Bangalore to Chennai for 21st. Now it took you to a screen, which is showing you a list of flights, and the question that is being asked is, which flight would you like to book? Now you should not force the user to only speak back. Because if it is only supposed to speak back, then the data that you're showing me on the list, then what am I, that I'm supposed to read that list, convert them to words, and then speak back to you. Instead, you should be able to now speak, scroll through the list, and touch and click on a particular list, an item on the list. And that's another way of now saying it. Or you might just be able to now speak, see something on the list and then speak it out. Both should be possible. I actually made a mistake by saying it. But yeah. So you should, as soon as you select a flight, now move on to the next screen. Now you're not, I could have spoken or I could have used my screen to be able to now continue. To be able to now do this. This is the kind of thing that you want to be able to do. Another interesting thing is the notion of error handling. You want to make sure this is super critical, especially in voice, because there are lots of possibilities of errors. Like it's the equivalent of like people keep clicking a button and nothing responding. Now there we don't know what's happening, but in the voice world you sometimes know what's happening, so you can now respond properly. So the first thing kind of a thing is like when no speech is detected, the user clicked and wanted to speak, but he did not actually speak. Now what do you do for it? Now should I continue or should I just silently get away from it? That's an error handling state that you want to be able to now do. Or you detected a speech, but nothing was recognized.
speech was like, it's all gibberish. I didn't really recognize anything that actually spoke out of the person. Oh, how do you handle that kind of thing? Or you recognize a speech, but I recognize it completely wrong. Right? Give me curd rice was recognized as give me cold rice. Right? So now what do you do in that kind of a scenario? What are we supposed to handle that scenario? Recognized but not handled. Right? Like, I don't know what to handle. I got the system, but I don't know what you said. For example, just said good morning. Now I have no intent which handles good morning. Right? So now what am I supposed to do? This is another example that we did when we did a user research for some of the apps. Like when we went to sort of some people, the first instinct, as soon as they click, they don't click and start speaking. They don't give a command. They click and say, good morning or hello. That's their first instinct. And they expect the system to speak back to them. If it doesn't speak back to them because they spoke, they are not going to hear. And then another thing is like, they don't speak like this. They speak like this. Right? Even though it's a visual app. Because that's how we are used to some things like, hello. Then if there is no audio back, you're essentially lost that particular transaction. You're frustrated with a particular user. Because this is all new user behavior. So you're now trying to now experiment with new user behavior and marrying with a traditional user behavior where with phones. The existing model is like phones. Right? So how do you now marry this? What are the things to be handled? Not handling at an application layer. Like everything went fine from a NLP and intent perspective. Everything got done well. But then the application cannot handle it. Like book a flight to Chennai. I don't have a flight to Chennai. Now how do you now handle that error? And the last is like you spoke an error. There was some, you didn't understand. Now, do you keep asking the same question again and again? You don't want to keep asking the same question again and again because then the user is exactly going to say the exact same thing. Right? Then, and you're going to get into this, nothing is going to move and you're only going to frustrate the user. So every time you ask an error, the next time you want to be able to now say a different kind of an error. Maybe more descriptive error. And then a more descriptive error. Like essentially it could be like, hey, first time you say, sorry, I didn't get it, can I try it again? Now the next time is like, he's saying the same thing. Then you also probably want to prompt him saying, hey, by the way, you can say things like this. Then you didn't get it, then okay, maybe like, oh, give me one more time or next time just show him a list of possible choices that are available. Because then you train this user like, okay, this is the kind of thing that you can now speak. Those are all possible. And also handling noise and experience users. Like sometimes you don't want descriptive responses back because it's very irritating for people who are already very used to it. But if it is a new user, you want to be very descriptive in how you are explaining back the user. But if it is an experienced user, because typically what happens is like when you are now speaking back an error, until the error is completed, error message is completed, I can't retry. That's a limitation that comes with voice. Because when you're speaking, now if you start listening at the same time, listening will listen to your own speech. Now that becomes the intent, that's an unfortunate problem. So you have to wait till the error message is completely spoken out and then you can speak. But if it's a long error message, then you're losing out the user. Experienced users will get frustrated. But first time users probably want that. So to be able to differentiate between a first-time user and an experienced user. So these are all some things. And then some brain candy. So just like there are UI patterns that exist, there are a lot of these kind of VAX patterns that you will start seeing. Once you start getting into this world, you'll start realizing there are a lot of common patterns that you can apply between multiple applications. They are not, every application is not very unique per se. Like things like list. How do you show a list? And how do you expect people to speak out a list? Right? How do you select from a list? If people have used Google Show, the home show, you'll see that there are some ways in which they allow you to now process a list. Go next, select the second item, select the third item. Like so there are some ways in which you can now process, and list processing can be done. Filters, like show me only or do not show me black, like the inverse and the for conditions. You'll be able to handle. Now, the main thing is handling the inverse and recognizing the inverse and the true, but whether it is black or medium, or 200 rupees, the way of applying is similar, but the fact that these are the kind of filters that can apply is what you want to be able to understand. And the way people will ask for help, like the way people will, when they're saying like, they're not going to say help. That's not the natural way to now say help. Like, yeah, I don't know what to do. Like that could be the way they will explain. So now how do you know handling that kind of a scenario? Right? What do I do now? Right? Now what do I do now is very different from I don't know what to do. Right? Like you have to be able to now handle those things. And then conversation markers. So stringing intents, like how do you, sometimes people want to be able to connect multiple things together, right? Like this is another thing that is there. For example, in when you're ordering food, right? The classic way is like, hey, add two pizzas to my list, right? Or like add three garlic bread to my list. That's one way. Another way is like, hey, add two pizza, three garlic bread, four Pepsi cans. My wife will kill me if I say this, but so like you can keep stringing multiple sentences together in a single form. And this kind of a list processing mechanism is quite possible. Like this kind of list mechanism will exist in multiple cases. Like in Book My Show, like it's like I want to book this ticket for two people, and maybe like something. Sorry, I'm just throwing out of the bat, but there are things that you could potentially do here. Another thing that can start coming in is personality. So that's something that voice can now start giving you. Because typically when you have an app, right? So now the way people now start, like exactly like the word Alexa, like when you use Alexa, you know, Alexa brand has a personality. Right? There's a notion that she's smart, and but that's the way they're trying to build, because that's a centralized personality where brands are sitting behind that personality. So you having individual personality becomes vital. But now when you're now inserting voice experience into your app, to your brand, you can now start giving a personality. Hey, smarty, like whatever, like you can keep a name, like the way people want to be able to now refer to it. It's not just a command that they'll give. They might prefix it in some sentences. And you know, want to give an error back. Hey, dude, sorry, man, I didn't understand what you're talking about. Right? Like, whether you want to be saying that versus like, sorry, I didn't understand what you're talking about. Right? Now, there's a very different way in which you want to be able to now respond back, and the style in which you want to be able to respond back. That gives your brand a personality, which are sometimes harder visually to be able to now give a personality. Today's ways of visually giving personality is by colors and the layouts. So with voice, now the notion of personality starts coming out is like the way in which you, the error message. How do you now handle an error message? What are the sentences that you now allow? What is the name that you choose for your assistant? All of them starts becoming a part of your things. And how smart can you now handle? They're all good. And another thing with personality is like you can, we are working with a gaming company, for example. Mobile cricket game example. Now, when you don't talk to it, one way is like just keep speaking to the app. But what if you're, as if you're talking to an umpire in the app, right? Like you're immersing with your cricket game. Then you can say like, hey, umps, declare this match. Like, or like something like that. Essentially, you want to be able to now make it feel it's very native experience. And you want to be able to now talk to that person rather than just a boring command that you give. And another thing which you can potentially do is like notion of personalization. Like where you now start having personal commands for person. Right? He says like, hey, book me the usual. Right? I don't want to now go through the, like, you know, food, you know, book me the usual. Can you now figure it out very easily from here? Like it's a command which maybe specifically for me, I want to be able to not do. Or if I say like aloo one, yes. Maybe it's not a food item that typically exists. Like my classic problem, I don't know if it might, you guys see it. The only North Indian dish which I like is paneer butter masala. So every restaurant I go, I keep asking paneer butter masala. Now that guy says, this restaurant doesn't have paneer butter masala, but there is this something else paneer, I will give you. Doesn't matter. It has to look yellow, it has to look reddish and color, it has to have paneer. That's my paneer butter masala for me. It's like you give it to me. No, for me that is paneer, but I'm always going to call it as paneer butter masala. Doesn't matter what. Right? But now you don't want to centrally change the menu to handle stupid people like me. Right? So like, but now with voice, now you can map it to my personalization. You know, when I say this, this is what this person always means. To be able to now understand that person's more individual capabilities and now be able to now handle the record. Now, those are all things that you can potentially do. The last thing that you have to super worry when you now handle, the notion of privacy. So, moment you had voiced to anything, voice today has a lot of coolness factor. It has a lot of scariness factor. Like this, people are scared and amazed at it at the same time. There are a lot of stories that we keep hearing of Alexa, people hacking in and by buying, hacking in the sense like it's not even like a criminal hacking, it's a very, it just happened and then people make stupid mistakes and people end up having two things, and it is also possible to do criminal hacking and to be able to now do stuff. So there are concerns that starts coming in when you now exhibit this notion of voice as a medium to interact with your brand starts creating these extra problems potentially. Now you need to be cognizant of the fact, you can't say this. Now things like what we as a platform, for example, tiny things that we do, it's like we don't allow hot word detection. Now hot word detection is very cool. Like where you can just say, hey, okay, Google, or say something and then do it. But the problem is like it creates a lot of false positives. And your brand could get, you can start capturing in sentences with the user never meant to capture. Now every single company will have, now Google others probably can manage this, but like every single company we have to now start worrying about its privacy issues becomes a problem. So where you want to make sure like the intent of the user is to speak, and only then you do it. Don't allow inadvertent intents. Then when you now capture these voice things, don't personalize their information too much. Like they're storing, they're saying you something,
if you use third-party system, now the third-party system will store analytics about what you spoke. Now that could give you personally identifiable information. Now as this personally identifiable information not being saved or being saved, like how do you now make sure? Now those are all things that starts coming in. So worrying about what data that you capture, what and I'm like, hey, are you always listening to me? What if I make so those things will all start coming in. So we're now deciding you have to be cognizant of this fact that privacy issue, and then eliminate that thing very clearly, saying voice is only to help you navigate faster, do things faster. And only when you tell me, I will do it. Otherwise, I'm not going to, you don't even have to listen to me. I'm not listening to you at all. Make it very, very clear and very, very obvious in the way things happen. So this is all there now. Ways in which today you can do it is by, especially in Android and iOS systems, are two ways. One is what is called as an outside-in integration. So there is an assistant that exists, either it is Siri or Google Assistant inside your app. You can now, Siri, you can create what is called Siri shortcuts. And deep links can be exposed inside your application through Siri. People can talk to Siri and then go in. But that typically is like a one-shot thing. Like you speak and you get into the application. After that, you can't do anything with voice typically. Or you can't keep having back and having a conversation. It is typically one way. And even same with for Google Assistant. You can essentially trigger and launch your application. But after that, you are left with your touch-based system. Or you can do a much more in-app integration. Side note, marketing. So this is our product. So this is like where you can now you can have a customized integration inside your application. So where you can now have a voice experience right in and have that similar experience or have a back and forth, do a bunch of stuff inside this, and where you can focus and use systems like us to be able to do it. And the way you typically do it will, so ours and any system you do will end up being something similar. The first thing is to be able to design your user journeys. Just like how you design when you start, you don't start writing code. You figure out like, okay, where is the various screens that's going to happen? Here are the various flows that's going to happen, and I start coding in. Similarly, even for voice, you have to figure out what are the user journeys that person is going to take, and what are the intents that's going to come in, what are the ways in which somebody could speak, some samples, and then what are the data I have to be able to collect. And if this data is spoken, if this data is not spoken, what should I do? Right? All that has to be, and how do I map it to my visuals? You have to be able to do some kind of a high-level design journey. Then you typically configure them in a system where you say you describe all your intents. Describe your intents, you describe your sentences which will trigger that intents, the data that you need to be able to collect as part of the intent, all of them you describe visually in some dashboard kind of system. The third thing that you typically do is to test out this thing before you write code. See like is the intent detection working correct? Not working correct. When I'm speaking something, am I expecting, so that before I write any code, is my system even working correctly? You want to be able to now test that. Then fourth step is the notion of code. You then integrate a library into a system, or you directly use Google or whichever, but use ours library. Right. So use system to be able to now use, just plop in your library, and then the system will typically take care of everything that needs to be done. You only focus on the actions, because a system like us can only handle the question that the user, it can only handle the voice part. We can automatically collect the voice, do everything else that is handled with respect to the voice part, but we don't know how to actually do anything with that command. When the intent is satisfied, what to do? That's the business logic that the app has to take care of. So we have the systems like that, you just focus on your app actions and leave everything else to a framework to be able to now get it, get things done. And that gives you some of the things that we spoke about, to be able to now handle error escalation and everything automatically. So without you having to worry about like how to handle all those things. And the last but not the least is the notion of analytics. Because you can't get this done in one shot. Right? It's like I build something, I release it, oh, magic is going to happen. It's never going to happen. Your most first experience is going to be bad, because you will not imagine how people will speak. While you'll have it's not just about what they will speak, what will be missing, there'll be all those things that will happen. So you want to be able to now track analytics of what people are speaking and what is your most popular intents. And more importantly, what is not working. Now, what is not working is not like, oh, these new utterances which map to an intent are like completely new expectations. Now, as soon as the user clicks the button, and if your message says, hey, what can I do for you today? You are just opening up the entire world for him with respect to your app. Now you can just pick whatever and whatever that he imagines is possible with your app, right? In that particular case. So you want to be able to now tailor the expectations correctly by the message that you are now giving to the user, saying like, hey, would you like to order some food? Is one way to now curtail and say that message like, hey, what would you like to do today? If you can only handle order food at this point. So these are all things that you can, almost done, lastly. Yeah. So this is the things you can do. See, I said I'll stop. Thank you.
Great talk. So we have run out of time, but next we have break. So those of you who like to proceed for lunch can do, but we can just continue into the break for questions.
Okay. You're not trying to embarrass me. Great. Thank you, guys.